Come ride with me. It's time to saddle up right away. There's so much to see. Don't worry, I know the trails, I know the way.
Hello, this is Daniel Dauphin with Dauphin Horsemanship, and we're here today to talk about halter breaking a foal. Before I actually get hands-on with Scarlet here, I want to say just a couple of the things that I see routinely people do. One, most of the time when people do this, they're going to maybe have the mare in the foal and put them in a stall and kind of hem the foal up in the corner and just sort of put a halter on him, whether he's wanting that or not. I'm not real big on how old the foal is when you do this. If you want to do it when they're 5 days old and they're in a stall with the mother, I don't have any problem with that. So happens this is a foal that I got from a good friend of mine. So I basically got her when we weaned her. I've now had her a couple of months. She's 6 months or so at this point. And I've been kind of saving her to shoot this video. She has never had a halter on. She was pretty much wild when we got her. Not wild, but unhandled. And I've basically just been kind of petting on her when I feed and things like that and just getting her where she doesn't mind my company. And you can see she's come right up to me here in the round pen. One of the things that I'm not a big fan of the stall experience, halter breaking a colt, is that for ones that aren't gentle, okay, I mean, one like this wouldn't be an issue. But for that four-day-old baby that's still wild and goosey and running around, it's just a little too much pressure. You're always in close proximity to that baby because you're, you know, you can only get 12 feet away. If you're corner to corner, you're only 12 feet away. And so I'd rather get in a little bit bigger area. This is probably bigger than what would make life easy, but it's certainly big enough that if they get really scared, they can get away from me and the pressure can be taken off. Or really my preference, if I feel like they're feeling too much pressure, I will choose to walk away, allow them to stay there. But again, in a larger pen, I can get far enough away to really take the pressure off. This is a pretty vital moment for me, or for this colt and in our relationship, because really halter breaking and all of these things, this is the horse's introduction on learning how to learn. Okay, so if you mess this up, or you get the horse overly frightened and you kind of just cram the halter on and they deal with it, you're really setting the stage for things to come. So, you know, we're going to try to get this halter on her today. If I don't get the halter on her today, I'm fine with that. If it takes me 3 or 4 days to get the halter on her, I'm fine with that too. I'm not in any rush. I've got a couple of years before any of this is important. So. Don't get in a rush with your baby. To me, it's way more important that they're comfortable when the halter is put on than it is that the halter gets put on. All right. So a lot of the colts that I get in probably had an experience similar to that, where they were hemmed up in a corner. I've had people that ran them up into like a cow squeeze chute, put a halter on that way. You know, not ideal, but it doesn't mean that it's unfixable. It's just not the best approach. This is what I feel like is the best approach. I hand make my halters and lead ropes and things, if you can't tell, but that kind of has the homespun feel to it. This is the first foal halter I've ever done. I'm kind of just guesstimating it's going to be the right size for her. We'll see. But I just want to be around the colt. I want to pet on them. And just kind of walk around and love on them a little bit. Let me see if I can direct her a little more to the middle of the pen where the camera will see her good. I really like, with babies, I stay in this hip area with them quite a bit. Way too close. Okay. Back her up a little. back to it. I like to stay back here in this hip area quite a bit. Remember that babies are going to feel pretty defensive. And you are, you know, you're opening yourself up to getting kicked or something. But if you don't put too much pressure on them, keep them comfortable. That really shouldn't be such a big deal. Scarlet did one time when I was petting her back here, kind of jumped up and threatened to kick me, and I went wild on her. She's never done it again. I would recommend that you institute respect at this point. Okay, so if she were to do something really disrespectful, she tries to shoulder into me or maybe bite at me or kick at me or something, I'm going to treat her just like an old horse. I'm not going to just let that slide because she's a cute little baby. And because I didn't let that slide with that one attempt at kicking, that's been, I don't know, a month and a half ago, nothing has happened since. So I nipped that in the bud, and it's not an issue I'll have to deal with for the rest of her life. The ones that get away with that get emboldened, and you are going to have to deal with it for a long time, and you're going to have to take even more drastic measures to get that behavior stopped. One other little thing to keep in mind is don't just be on that left side all the time. Horses people tend to say that horses are 90% left-handed. I've seen that written lots of places. I haven't really found that to be true at all when I'm halter breaking colts. And I get a lot of colts in the break that aren't halter broken. I find it to be more like 60-40. I think most horses wind up being left-handed because we handle them on the left so much more. So here in the beginning, you've got a perfect opportunity to not allow that to start. I'll just rub her with the halter a little bit. Just ease it around her neck. If she kind of picked her head up, I'm just going to rub her and back away. That's all I want. Good girl. This is November. She's a woolly, woolly little booger. I don't know that I've ever had a foal that got this woolly. She's got a couple burrs stuck in her. As far as keeping foals, I've got her in with a pony. I don't want foals to be isolated from horses. At the same time, I don't want to take a foal away from its mom and then go throw it in a pasture with a bunch of grown horses that might hurt it. So she's kind of learning her herd education with the ponies, who will still keep her in line, but they're not going to hurt her. She's actually taller at this point than the ponies that she is in with. And we'll be getting another foal in shortly out of Belgian thoroughbred crossmare that we have. So I'm assuming that foal's going to be a little bigger than Scarlet here. Alright, she's just been as I'm petting her, she's just reaching back here and sniffing the halter. So we'll see if we can ease that up to her face a little. I'm not trying to put it on her nose, I'm just getting it in her face. One of the things, back away from her when I talk about this, that we need to be very conscious of when we're introducing halters to horses is that the way a horse's eye works, they cannot focus at all within 18, 20 inches of their head. So when you're going to put this halter on her and you're kind of in that space around her head, this is just a big blurry blob to her. She can't identify it, so it's a lot more prone to be scary going on there than we give it credit for. Because for me, you know, you can put that right up to me and I can see it perfectly fine. Not the case with your horse. That's why those whiskers are there on their nose. They cannot actually see the grass they're grazing on. It's too close to them. They have to feel it. Okay. So definitely take your time there. Don't just try to get it on and spook them. Again, them being comfortable throughout this process is really my highest priority. I've got a lot of time to get this done. It doesn't have to be done in 5 minutes. So there's really no excuse for me rushing it at all. I'm just going to
kind of rub it on her mouth there a little bit. That's all I want. We'll do the same on this side.
I've had folks, when doing this, try to bite the halter and put it in their mouth. I just let them do it. I don't have any feelings about that. Perfectly fine for them to do that. Okay, I'm seeing this halter that I have made for her is pretty close to too small. I think I can get away with it for today, but maybe a month or so, but chiseling out, broke this one pretty quick. One other little thing I'll say, like, I haven't put a halter on her. I have in this pen before. We actually filmed it, but for technical reasons, it didn't work out. I have had ropes around this filly. So I've followed her around the round pen a fair bit with a rope on her neck, and then given her a little pressure on that rope, and kind of taught her to yield to it. So she's already got a very basic and minor understanding of yielding to pressure, which is, again, you know, that's really what all this stuff is about. You'll also notice when I am going to ask her, I'll have the halter on her here in just a second, I think. When I do ask her to move her feet, I don't ask her to come straight ahead. I do it to the side, which kind of gets her off balance, makes it a little more likely that she's going to take that step forward. Okay, so we've moved her here where hopefully she's in prime space for the camera. Let her hold that rope for me, and we're going to attempt to get the halter on her now. You can see as I touched her whiskers with the halter there, she picked her head up just a little. Well, this is really a little too small. Sometimes the only way you learn something is to do it. Okay, and she's got a couple burrs right here. Right by where that halter strap, I thought I had picked them all off, but she's so dead and woolly. Hard to see everybody. Okay. All right. So we've got the halter on her for the first time. You can see she's real shaken up about the experience. And this is really exactly how I wanted that to go, okay? She's nice and calm. She didn't even feel the urge to take a step away from me. This really is the first time that she's ever had the halter on. And that's, like I said, I couldn't have asked for that to have gone any better. All right, so we'll do just a little bit of leading training now. I will say, when I get 2-year-olds, 3-year-olds in that aren't halter broke, after this process, I'll lead them around a little bit. I find with those horses, they can handle more pressure. I generally am going to go to my saddle horse, and I'm going to pony them to get them really halter broke. The reason that I do that is I have a nice horse that I do that on, and I'm pretty experienced with it, but I can just get it done very quickly on my horse. In 30 minutes, I'll have them trotting up along beside me and all that stuff. It takes me, you know, 4 times as long to do that on the ground. With a baby like this, I wouldn't start that way for sure. One other thing that I want to say right now, I have absolutely zero plans of tying this filly up for probably a year. I have no idea why you would ever need to tie a foal. It's extremely easy for them to injure their necks. I'm not a fan of the inner tubes and all those things that people tie horses with. I would have no problem once I've done a little of these exercises with taking her up to the pipe fence, maybe wrapping the rope around it twice, or doing like a blocker tie where she can back away, but I don't want them tied hard and fast in any fashion until they're long yearlings, basically. So that's my advice. Some people ask, how do you start tying colts up? My answer is, at this age, I don't. Okay? I wouldn't mind getting her hobble trained or anything like that at this point. I just don't want, they can really injure themselves very easily. I've seen several really nice horses that wound up with never even got broke because they injured their necks pretty severely when they were babies at this stage from being tied. So just don't, not worth the risk. Okay, so we're going to start leading her around here a bit. Again, I'm going to do that to the side. I'll say that, again, this is the horse's introduction to pressure and release. The vast majority of the people that I see doing this, and I've even watched some of the videos on YouTube on people instructed how to do this, they don't release. It is absolutely critical that you do that if you want to do the best job for your horse. So what I'm trying to get here is one pull on the lead rope, one step forward. And even initially, I'll accept backward steps, as long as I get some movement, and then I can direct the movement. I'm not going to try to just hold and pull and drag her 30 feet. Okay? Not at all what we're going for here. And again, I'm going to do that to the side, not straight ahead. As I get it really easy to the side, then I'll start straightening that line where I'm kind of more at a 45, and then I'll be straight off. Okay, so nice soft little place on her hand. If you can see my hand, and there she gave. I don't even have this rope gripped. Okay, I want her responding just to the friction. This would be what contact would be in a bridle. And you can see she started lean and shift her weight. I knew that step was coming, and then as soon as she picked that foot up, I gave to her. And look how much quicker it's coming here. This all forms of training that involve pressure and release, in technical terms, this is negative reinforcement, and it is. Please, in the comments, don't have some 14-year-old kid telling me that I don't know what negative reinforcement is. This is the technical scientific definition of negative reinforcement. What negative reinforcement is, and it's pretty much what natural horsemanship is based on, the word negative doesn't mean anything bad happens. It means that the stimulus is taken away. It's removed from the equation. So I put pressure on. That's the stimulus. The horse responds, I remove the pressure. That is the negative reinforcement of the action, okay? Positive reinforcement would be like clicker training and things along those lines. We also have positive and negative punishment. Positive punishment would be if I'm trying to punish an action so that it doesn't reoccur, and I'm doing that by adding something. So if I were to whack her with a lead rope on the butt for kicking at me, that would be positive punishment. Negative punishment we don't use for training animals pretty much at all. It's too abstract of a concept, but what negative punishment would be is let's say your teenager does something at school and you ground them, take away their computer for a week or cell phone or something like that. You're discouraging an action by removing something. So that's what negative punishment would be. So, all of this, almost all horsemanship, is negative reinforcement. All right? A little bonus for y'all there. So we'll do this again a couple directions. All right? I really like how she's kind of tilting her head. Coming, she's just yielding right again. You know, y'all have seen every last bit of what she's had here. She's pretty laid back, little filly. She is, by the way, this is a straight cutting bred colt. She is out of a cat's red feather mare and an SR instant choice and hickory bred stallion. She will be one of my personal demo horses in the upcoming years. I'm getting just a little more, look look at that. She came with a float and a line. That was her first little response like that. Okay. And you can see we're kind of getting a few steps now. And notice I am just staying in little circles. I haven't tried to lead her off straight yet. Scarlet here. I like everything she's showing me. Okay, and if she were to want to walk away with this rope, like I'm letting her go a little ways there, I didn't try to stop her, and say she stopped within the range of the rope. So now I'm going to ask her again to just come to me. And release. Always release. Reinforce that good behavior. You will notice I have gotten a little more specific about what I'm doing here. I'm not releasing for every step at this point, like as I'm asking her to turn 90 degrees. A lot of times the first step she's taking is back with the inside front foot. And I'm not releasing for that. I'm releasing when the outside hind crosses over. Okay. So we'll hold that and release that. A lot of people don't ride this technically, but when I am riding a colt, I'm asking specifically for steps like that. And there's no reason why you can't begin that here. Now that time, that inside foot I did reward, but she stepped forward with it, not back. There. Very nice. Very good girl, Scarlet. And a nice deep breath with her. So see, this is her first halter break session. She didn't flip over backwards. She didn't get scared, hemmed up in a corner, or anything like that. You can see we mended it here, and I mean, she is just as relaxed and chilled out as she could be, which is exactly how I want it. To me, unless I'm pretty certain I can have a session like this with a colt, then I need to do more petting on and getting them comfortable before I try to put the halter on and begin directing them. This is what a first haltering should be. We will proceed. I'm going to keep Scarlet up in a stall just by herself for a few days, and we're going to progress this and try to pick up her feet. Get her first little hoof trimming and so forth, and then I'm going to just kick her loose for a while longer and kind of let her grow up a bit. We'll just get her up periodically to keep her feet trimmed and things like that. We'll try to film some of that for you, where maybe you can see the beginning handling of her feet in the first trim or something along those lines. But okay, I'm going to just take this halter off of her now. Definitely make her a bigger one. There we go. Okay, that's been a few tips on halter breaking a foal. I hope y'all enjoyed that. Maybe got a little something good out of it. It's Daniel Dauphin, Dauphin Horsemanship. Please check out our website and like and subscribe to our YouTube channel. We'll have upcoming videos, hopefully with some more good training tips and maybe something a little bit amusing and entertaining every so often. Thank y'all much.